Hello everyone, welcome to the ITS Academy. Our today's lecture is on the topic metabolic response to injury. In a previous lecture, we have discussed about the nutritional support. Now, in continuation with that lecture, we will discuss about metabolic response towards the different injuries that occurs in our body. So, metabolic response to injury, the term metabolic response to injury describes the biochemical and hormonal consequences of the major injury, trauma, surgery, injection, and the resulting nutritional changes that may have very significant clinical effect. So traditionally, the response has been described as having two phases known as the ebb and flow. So, the recent studies have shown that good acute clinical management may reduce or possibly eliminate the ebb phase, and that it may not be detectable at all in less severe injury. So, related to this, there may occur the overall effect, which comprises of loss of appetite, which leads to decrease in nutritional intake. There is also chances of perturbation of fat and carbohydrate metabolism with apparent inability to use these as metabolic substrate, and hence increase circulating levels and deposition of lipids in adipose and vital organs. Controlling hypoglycemia by giving insulin will help to decrease the risk of death. And also, lean tissue broken down may provide amino acids required during inflammatory response, for example, the acute phase protein, lymphocyte proliferation, and glutathione synthesis. Along with this, protein loss may be substantial and have clinical consequences in context of whole body protein. Lean tissue contains approximation of 205 gram of protein per kg. Leads to an average of 70 kg man comprises 10 kg protein. So most of this protein is essential and cannot be lost without function, and also implications for that is decreased resistance to infection, increased muscle weakness, including respiratory and skeletal muscle, leading to decreased pulmonary functions and decreased physical activity. Along with this, occurs the effect of starvation also. So, although there are some similarities between the metabolic response to injury and starvation, that is, both lead to depletion, there are important differences. So, let's talk about the next topic, critical care. That is defined as patient requiring advanced respiratory support. And secondly, basic respiratory support together with the support of at least two organ system, including the patient with multi-organ failure. So the aim of nutrition support in critical care patient are to minimize nutritional losses and provide basic nutrient requirement to sustain life. Repletion of pre-existing undernutrition during a period of critical care is unlikely to be achieved and should not be a goal because of increased risk associated with overfeeding. Now let's discuss about route of feeding. So access of feeding routes may be limited by the patient condition, but wherever possible, the gut should be used as first choice. So enteral feeding and parenteral nutrition are required in this. Enteral feeding we have discussed in our previous lecture, its first part, that there is a evidence to support to the early initial of enteral feeding in critical care patient. This will require a standard initial regime to be available to all the clinical staff so that feeding can commence as soon as possible. So gastric aspirate should be checked every 4 to 6 hours. Volume greater than 200 ml with nasogastric feeding and greater than 150 ml with gastrostomy feeding are acceptable. The gastric aspirate above these levels indicate delayed gastric emptying, but a single high measurement should not lead to the cessation of the feeding unless there is a overt regurgitation or sign that patient is aspirate fluid into the respiratory tract. So the enteral feeding and in parenteral nutrition, the parenteral nutrition can play an invaluable role where enteral feeding is not possible. Avoidance of overfeeding is important here, and maintaining good glycemic control, that is the blood glucose, and avoiding swings in blood sugar level are associated with the lower mortality. Additional insulin may be required to achieve this. Next is your point in critical care is nutritional requirements in critical care. Firstly, you have to keep in mind the energy source. Energy requirement can be estimated by calculation using the standard formula, but resulting values provided only an approximation and may need adjusting to suit individual's patient. So energy requirement are slightly decreased if patient are ventilated or rather than breathing spontaneously, but it will increase as weaning progresses. So patient sedated using propofol with receive additional energy from the lipid emulsions. It is carried in 1% to 2% propofol contained between. And the maximum dose recommended as 70 kg in critical care. And there is an also requirement to check in protein and nitrogen. So critical care patients have greater protein turnover and greater nitrogen loss is an unavoidable feature of the metabolic response to injury. So nutritional support will not reduce this, but will help in minimizing the accompanying depletion. And nitrogen, generally greater than 0.2 gram nitrogen per kg body weight per day has no additional benefit in septic or trauma of patient. Third one is your carbohydrate requirement. So in critical illness, glucose administration should not exceed the maximum glucose oxidation rate of 4 mg per kg per minute. And the lipid, if you talk about lipid in critical illness, should be lie between 0.8 to 1 gram per kg per day. Approximately 3 to 4.5% of the total energy should be provided as lipid to prevent essentially fatty acid deficiency. Now, along with this, there is an also requirement of some fluid, electrolytes and macronutrients, and but there is no evidence is available about a specific requirement in critical care of the patients of requirement of these elements. So let's talk about the surgical patients. Nutritional depletion is associated with increased morbidity and mortality following the surgery. So surgery itself is associated with increased nutritional losses, and the nutritional support is not able to prevent this. For this, appropriate nutrition support is capable of minimizing the depletion, that is the loss of lean body mass accompanying major surgical interventions, and is associated with the depletion of lean body mass, improved skeletal muscle force, decreased fatigability, increased ventilatory cardiac and gut function, increased immunity, increased sense of well-being. So there is a less evidence that nutritional support has beneficial effect in relatively well-nourished individuals who have undergone through minor or moderate surgery, indicating that routine nutritional support for all the surgical patient is inappropriate, especially if we considering the potential side effects of feeding and cost implication. So it is widely accepted that patients who are critically ill or severely injured or nutritionally depleted prior to surgery will benefit from the nutritional support. And it generally raises two topics, two issues, that are identifying the patient who will benefit and optimum timing of nutritional support. So in this, first comes your pre-operative nutrition. In this regard, if we talk about, then comes your pre-operative nutrition. For this, in pre-operative nutrition, feeding undernourished patient for 7 to 10 days prior to surgery is associated with a reduction in non-infection complications. Shorter periods show no benefit, but obviously delaying surgery is clinically inappropriate in some patients, but preoperative feeding should be considered in those who are severely depleted. It is also related with perioperative nutrition. So perioperative nutrition, in this, overnight fasting prior to surgery may be unnecessary. Evidence suggests that allowing patient to take clear fluid until 2 hours before surgery is safe and may have some benefits. So oral carbohydrate, that is 50 gram, and fluid loading prior to surgery is generally associated with reduced post-operative insulin resistance, improved well-being, and it decreases the length of hospital stay. Lastly, the nutrition deals with the post-operative nutrition. So in this, initiating internal enteral feeding within the first 24 hours after the surgery is safe in most patients. So even those undergoing abdominal surgery, including major trauma and liver transplantation, it is not, however, risk-free, but complications can be minimized by good clinical practice, including careful monitoring. Now, next is your injury is a spinal cord injury, that is SCI. A spinal cord injury can result in either temporary and permanent impairment of the normal motor sensory or autonomic function. For this, tetraplegia, that is the injury to the spinal cord in the cervical region with associated loss of function in all four extremities. And second one is your paraplegia. In this, the injury in the thoracic, lumbar, or scleral segment resulting in loss of function in the lower limbs. So here, if we talk about, the first comes your short-term nutritional issues. In patient should, in short-term nutritional issues, that is greater than 3 months after injury, patient should undergo assessment to determine their nutritional status as soon as possible after injury, and determining their body weight may be difficult. Estimating requirement may be inaccurate due to the variation in individual's need and other coexisting injuries. So nutritional support may be required if the patient is unable to eat sufficient and if he or she is going through the depression, anxiety, and frequent clinical investigations. And treatment may also limit the intake. So input from registered dietitian is needed to optimize the nutritional care. Next is your longer term nutritional issues. So in longer term nutritional issues, what happens? An optimum nutrient intake will help support an active rehabilitation program. This will include the provision of adequate energy to participate in physiotherapy session and sufficient protein and micronutrients to facilitate any continuing healing process and minimize the complication associated with the limited mobility. For example, the loss of skin integrity. Constipation is very common and can have a serious impact on quality of life and long-term health. And the degree of bowel dysfunctions depends on the extent and location of the injury on the spinal cord, with the complete damage above the 12th thoracic vertebra. So the next injury is your head injury. Patient sustaining brain damage through external injury to the head or surgery to treat the CVA, that is cerebrovascular accident, will require nutritional support in short and long term. For this, nutrition is not a priority immediately after injury, as resuscitations and emergency surgery may be required to preserve life. So in the following days, patient may become hypermetabolic and hypercatabolic as a consequence of metabolic response to injury. So requirement should be calculated on an individual basis by dietitian with experience in caring for critically ill. For here, the energy requirement is important, in which resting energy expenditure may increase up to approximation of 145% of the normal, although this increase may be moderated by pharmaceutical sedation. Energy expended through physical activity is usually minimal, and most head injured patients are well nourished at the time of injury, although this should not be consumed. Next is the requirement of protein. So protein is used as a preferred source of energy. So nitrogen losses increases in the first week post-injury and may remain raised for some week. It is reported that nitrogen losses vary from 0.29 to 0.73 gram per kg a day body, and negative nitrogen balance results. So monitoring nitrogen loss will give an indication of requirement, and although feeding cannot prevent nitrogen loss, it will minimize consequences. Providing 0.35 gram of nitrogen per kg body weight is associated with better outcome than the lower intake. Last is your nutritional support. Means systematic review has shown that instigation of early nutritional support is associated with decreased relative risk of death, and it also suggests that parenteral nutrition support is associated with a more favorable outcome than the internal enteral feeding. But this may be confounded by the fact that parenteral feeding usually commences earlier. Next injury comes your burn injury. Many of you get faced the burn injury. So assessment of nutritional requirement is very important. Means you have to go for through the medical history, that total percent body surface area burn, or you have to study the patient properly, that the percent full thickness or partial thickness area of the body burn, face, hand, smoke inhalation injury most significant. So history and type of injury is up to know. The history and type of injury is very important. That is the flame, hot liquid, contact means by which the injury has been caused. Previously, a medical history, for example, diabetes, gastrointestinal tract problem. So these all are the medical histories comes on during the assessment of nutritional requirement, because when you study these history, medical history, then only you will be able to design proper nutrition plan, proper diet for a particular patient who is suffering from burn injury. Next comes your social factor. So in social factor, the nutritional status on admission will be affected by physical health, mental health, income, cooking skills, and home circumstances. Your body weight measured immediately on admission to calculate fluid resuscitations, regimes, and energy requirement. Your diet history is very important, because assessment of nutritional intake prior to admission is to know is important. Food preference, what special dietary requirements, whether it is vegetarian or non-religious relief or not. Next is your energy assessment of nutritional requirement related to the energy. So thermal injury results in higher production of catecholamines, producing a hypermetabolic response. So this results in accelerated protein and fat breakdown and altered carbohydrate metabolism. Energy required are accessed using this specific formula. Then comes your protein requirement. Okay. Protein requirement in adult, it is given 20% of energy as protein, and in children less than 1 year, use reference nutrient intake as RNI. Trace aliment, then electrolyte and mineral, and what minerals and vitamins. Patient with total body surface area burn greater than 20%. are at risk of copper-zinc selenium depletion due to loss through the burn exudates. Electrolytes, if we talk about, then depletion can result from large losses in exudates, urine diarrhea, vomiting, and pyrexia. Replacement should take place intravenously according to biochemical parameter, and hypernatremia can result from dehydration from higher sodium loads administered from IV fluids with insufficient free water for excretion. Lastly is your mineral and vitamins. So increases loss of phosphate and magnesium occurs through the urine and exudates. Vitamins should be given to meet recommended daily intake. So it is estimating that energy requirement in burn injury, these all are the assessment that you should go through whenever planning any nutritional plan for the patient who is suffering, who has a case of burn. Feeding routes also be decided, that whether you have to feed it orally or nasogastric or nasojejunal feeding. In oral feeding, these all are the routes I have discussed in your previous lecture. So in oral feeding, in well-nourished patient with no confusion of facial swelling, burn injury, or oral nutrition using food supplement drinks is usually successful. And in nasogastric or nasojejunal feeding, the necessary in patient with burn of greater than 20%, the target is to commence within 4 hours of admission. If gastric status develop, then nasojejunal feeding is usually successful. So total parenteral feeding is rarely used due to the risk of infection. Next is your clinically functional nutrients. So also referred to as novel substrate. These include the nutrients that may have some clinical benefits if given in larger than usual intake in specific medical conditions. So the first substrate is your glutamine. Glutamine is conditionally indispensable amino acids. It is an important source of fuel in rapid dividing cells, enterocytes, and immune cells. Precursors, it is a precursor for antioxidant glutathione. It becomes indispensable in stress situation, for example, catabolic patients, as body pool decreases rapidly to fuel stimulated lymphocytes, etc. It is a standard parenteral solution. Do not include the glutamine. So glutamine supplementation is associated with clinical benefits, including decrease in mucosal atrophy after prolonged parenteral nutrition, and decrease bacterial translocation, and increase systematic immune function. Next substrate is your arginine. So arginine is conditionally indispensable amino acids. It plays a role in transport, storage, and excretion of nitrogen. It is a precursor of nitric oxide and becomes indispensable in stress situation, for example, trauma and sepsis. When arginine level decreases, as it is used for nitric oxide pathway. So arginine supplementation may benefit the microcirculation and protein anabolism, and has been associated with increased muscle and protein metabolism in intestinal motility. There are concerns that increased arginine intake is in septic patient may increase the nitric oxide production, resulting in hypertension and poor perfusion, and increased risk of multi-organ failure. So these all are the clinically functional nutrients that could may be given at a time to a patient. For more information, please log on to our website www.itlsacademy.com, and you can also follow us on Instagram, Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter, LinkedIn, and yes, do not forget to subscribe our channel ITLS Academy at YouTube. Thank you.